there, my name is Karyn O'Connor. I'm a professional singing teacher and the writer of SingWise.com. And today, as per request, I'm going to tackle a topic that many singers and singing teachers find confusing and intimidating, and that topic is vocal formants. I'm going to explain what formants are, as well as what harmonics and overtones are. And without getting into the real nitty-gritty of resonance tuning, I'm going to explain the very basics of how formants and harmonics interact with each other to create greater vocal power, better intelligibility, and improved resonance overall, as well as just richness in our voices. Now, in the process of explaining this, I'm hoping to answer the questions, how is this relevant to my singing? Do I really need to know this stuff? And what has a formant ever done for me? Now, I understand that singers are artists, not academics, primarily, and I certainly don't expect everybody to be as endlessly fascinated with voice science as I am. However, I'm hoping that this video today inspires those of you who wish to take your singing to the next level to delve a little bit more deeply into this truly fascinating topic, which I'm going to explain momentarily. So, let's dig into this topic. Formants are the resonance frequencies of the vocal tract. Now, every resonating cavity resonates at its own frequency. Let's take, for example, the pipes of a pipe organ. The longer, wider pipes resonate at lower frequencies. They have lower pitch, while the shorter and narrower pipes resonate at higher frequencies. They have higher pitch. Now, our resonator tract, which extends from the top of the vocal folds in the larynx to the edge of the lips, or if the nasal port is open, to the nostrils, is not quite like the pipes of a pipe organ, in that it's not of uniform shape or size, and it's highly adjustable. It has a bend, a potential second or side branch when the nasal port is opened, and it has all these little nooks and crannies in there. And some of those smaller cavities are resonators in and of themselves. They're capable of resonating at their own frequencies. So this means that our vocal tract, unlike a pipe and a pipe organ, is capable of resonating at multiple frequencies, which we call formants. Now let's talk really briefly about how we can adjust our formants. The lower two formants, which are labeled the first and second formants, are those that are most relevant to speech or to vowel differentiation, and are also the most highly adjustable. And for these reasons, they're often referred to as the vowel formants. They're altered by the varying positions and shapes and actions of our articulators, in particular the tongue, the jaw, the mouth or lips, the soft palate, the pharynx, and the larynx. Now, for today, we're going to refer to the entire resonator tube or tract as the vowel cavity or the vowel space. Now, many singers and even some teachers mistakenly associate vowel formation with the mouth only. And I'm going to explain why this is kind of a slippery slope to go down and how it can lead to sort of shallow and poorly defined vowels. Now, let's just say, for the sake of simplifying this topic, that the pharynx, which is the largest resonating cavity or vocal tracts, and therefore resonates at the lowest frequency, is the first formant space, while the oral cavity, which is the second largest resonating cavity, is our second formant space. Now, to state that the pharynx is the first formant space and the oral cavity is the second formant space is a bit of an oversimplification. In actuality, the interactions between the pharyngeal and oral cavities are far more complex than I'm making them out to be here, but we're just going to go with this for today. So, the tongue forms a movable partition between the pharynx and the oral cavity. We're going to say that this is the mouth here. So when we form the vowel E, for example, the tongue is high and it's fronted. Additionally, the lips are laterally spread, and the jaw is in a near-closed position. The two sets of teeth, the upper and lower rows of teeth, are nearly touching each other. So this means that there's actually very little space in the oral cavity for resonance. which means, and again, remember that smaller resonating cavities resonate at higher frequencies. This means that the second formant is higher. Now, at the same time, the high and forward tongue allows ample space in the pharynx for resonance. It makes it a larger space, which means that it resonates at a lower frequency, and therefore the first formant is lower. Now, the ah vowel is on the opposite end of the extreme here. The tongue is low and back. Additionally, the mouth is open and the jaw is low, which means that there is an incredible amount of resonating space in the oral cavity, which makes it resonate at a lower frequency. At the same time, however, the tongue hump and its root have now encroached upon the pharyngeal space, making this space smaller, and therefore the first formant frequency resonates at a higher frequency. So there's a bit of a trade-off in terms of space within the vowel cavity, and in order to differentiate the various sounds in our language, we merely reconfigure the vocal tract. So the listener distinguishes between E and ah based on the resultant formant frequency or spectral characteristics that come about from the unique vocal tract configurations for each vowel. Now, before I get too much further into this topic, I do need to take a moment to explain what harmonics and overtones are. Harmonics are the product of the sound source, and in the case of the vocal instrument, the sound source is the vibration of the vocal folds, or the vibrating vocal folds. When the vocal folds come together and air begins to pass through them, they vibrate very rapidly, which chops the exiting air into little puffs, which in turn creates a buzzing sound. Now, that buzzing sound is a complex tone made up of multiple frequencies, which we call harmonics. The lowermost harmonic is also called the fundamental frequency, or the fundamental, and it's also called the first harmonic. It's what we perceive as pitch because it's the loudest of all the harmonics, and the other harmonics are labeled as such: second harmonic, third harmonic, fourth harmonic, and so forth. Now, the overtones are also harmonics, but they do not include the fundamental frequency. So they're labeled as such: fundamental frequency, right? First overtone, second overtone, third overtone, and so forth. So that's basically the distinction between harmonics and overtones. So this brings us to the question of how formants and harmonics interact with each other. Now remember that every time we reshape our vocal tracts, whether we lengthen it, shorten it, widen it, narrow it, move that tongue around, reshape the lips, we're essentially changing the frequencies at which the resonator resonates. So in doing this, this enables us to raise or lower those vowel formants. And our goal ultimately is to try to raise or lower them so that their frequencies align or match the frequencies of one or more of the harmonics of the voice source. And when that happens, when they do converge, when they come together, that creates a more powerful sound, and it's more resonant, it's more rich, and intelligibility is also assisted. Now, we have no control over the harmonics except to change our phonation frequency. That is, to change the pitch at which we are singing. So every time the fundamental frequency, our pitch, moves up or down, the harmonics, the rest of the harmonics in the series, move up or down with it. So this leaves them as kind of moving targets when it comes to resonance tuning, which means that we also must continually readjust our resonator tracts in order to match those harmonic frequencies and give our voices that powerful acoustic boost that we're aiming for. Now, for singers to adjust our formants in order to tune them to a harmonic, it's simply a matter of making subtle adjustments to our vocal tracts, to our resonator tracts. Now, this is partly a matter of knowing which adjustments will cause which changes in the formant frequencies, but it's largely a matter of experimentation, of sustaining the tone and moving things around just very subtly, making small adjustments and seeing what ultimately produces the best sound, the most powerful sound, the most efficiently produced sound, the most resonance, the most ring in the voice. Now, for centuries, singers have been learning to tune their resonances, and their teachers have been helping them do so without an understanding of what formants were, or are, and without the aid of spectrographs. They did it basically by trial and error, exactly as we do it today. So you can totally do this. So I hope this video today has explained this complicated topic in a way that makes better sense for you. And if you have any further questions, feel free please to leave comments below or to email me at Karyn@SingWise.com, that's Karyn@SingWise.com, or you can message me on the SingWise Facebook page and I will be happy to try to explain it in a different way for you. Thank you so much for tuning in and I will see you next time.